Hello everyone, welcome to Shell Lectures. So in this video we'll be talking about the living world, a class 11 NCERT biology topic. So without any delay, let's get into the topic. So first let's look at introduction. So when we talk about the unique features of living organisms, immediately a lot of features come into our mind, like growth, reproduction, ability to sense environment and mount a suitable response with our sense organs, and metabolism, ability to self-replicate, self-organize, interact and emergence. So all these are features of living organisms. Then three people and the books they wrote and what are they special for? That's what the other three points are speaking about. Talking about Aristotle, he is considered as the father of zoology or biology, and he wrote the book known as Historia Animalia and Scala Naturae. And Theophrastus, who is considered as the father of botany, wrote Historia Plantarum. And John Gray wrote Historia Generalis Plantarum. So these three books and these three people are important. They may ask you in one words. Okay, let's ask ourselves. An English naturalist who wrote the book Historia Generalis Plantarum and introduced the word species. We don't know who introduced the word species, but we learned just now the person who wrote the book Historia Generalis Plantarum. So it's none other than John Gray. So let's check the answer. Yeah, the answer is John Gray. So John Gray was the person who wrote the book Historia Generalis Plantarum. So what is growth? So we know that all the living organisms, be it unicellular or multicellular, they all grow by cell division. In plants, the cell division occurs throughout their life, but in animals, it occurs only up to a certain stage. But cell division may occur to replace the lost cells or the damaged tissues of the body, but it will occur only up to a certain stage. So what are the twin characteristics of growth? What do we tell as growth? How can we define growth as? Growth is nothing but increase in mass and increase in number of individuals. That's what is termed as growth. So the unicellular organisms, they undergo cell division and they form a lot of cells, which can easily be observed in vitro by just observing it through a microscope. You just can simply count the cells and then it will be increase. So in majority of higher organisms, growth and reproduction are mutually exclusive. That is, growth is not related to reproduction in majority of organisms, but still we have one exception to this where growth and reproduction are synonymous to each other. That is, they both are nearly equal. So if we take the increase in mass, I'm talking about the sixth point. If we take the increase in body mass as a criteria of growth, we can even tell that the mountains, then the boulders and the sand mounds, even they grow because we are just adding them up from outside. That is, accumulation of material occurs. So that is also a kind of growth which is taking place in non-living things too. But that is an extrinsic type of growth because we are accumulating materials from outside, whereas living beings grow from inside. That is a type of intrinsic growth. Obviously, a dead organism does not grow, but still, as non-living organisms also show growth, if we take increase in body mass as a criteria for growth, growth cannot be defined as a defining property of living organisms. Talking about reproduction, we know what reproduction is. It's production of progeny with more or less similar features to the parents. It just refers to sexual reproduction, but there is also another kind of reproduction, which is asexual reproduction, which takes place in fungi, which reproduces using asexual spores, which germinate during favorable conditions. And we have yeast and hydra, which reproduce through budding. And we have planaria, which reproduces through regeneration. And then we have fungi, protonema of mosses, and filamentous algae, which reproduce by fragmentation. Their body splits up into fragments and each fragment develops into a new individual. And also we have in unicellular organisms like amoeba or algae. I told you just now that reproduction and growth are mutually exclusive events in many organisms, with some exception which include amoeba or algae and in general the unicellular organisms. Here reproduction is what is called as growth. They both are nearly equal terms. Many organisms don't reproduce. Of course, mules, infertile human couples and workabees. These three are examples of organisms which do not reproduce. And obviously no non-living object can reproduce by itself, but still, as there are some living organisms which can't reproduce, reproduction cannot also be said as a characteristic of living organisms. Now let's talk about metabolism. So what is metabolism? The process of making biomolecules from small or big chemicals is called a metabolic reaction. That is, formation of biomolecules from small or big chemicals is known as metabolic reaction. So what is metabolism? Metabolism is nothing but the sum total of all the metabolic reactions happening in our body. So it's the total of all the chemical reactions occurring in our body. Obviously, no non-living body can exhibit metabolism, but still, metabolism can be carried out in cell-free systems, that is outside the living body, in test tubes. It's not, we cannot tell it as living or non-living, but you can tell it as a living reaction because it's a metabolic reaction which is occurring outside the body, but still it's a living reaction, but it's not living nor non-living. So you can tell that cellular organization is definitely the defining feature of life forms. So talking about ability to sense environment, this is important. Response to environmental stimuli, that is, we respond to the environment by means of physical, chemical or biological methods, and human beings, us and a lot of other organisms respond by our sense organs. So we have been provided with 5 sense organs with which we respond to the external stimuli. Talking about plants, they respond to light, water, temperature, pollutants and other organisms. So plants are responding to all of these, they sense environment and respond to all of these. And very important point is here, the third point, photoperiod. That's nothing but the response of organisms to light. That is, some are known as long day plants and some are known as short day plants, and they can grow only when they are exposed to light. That kind of a phenomenon is known as photoperiod, and it's definitely affecting reproduction in seasonal breeders. That is, plants which can reproduce only when they are exposed to light. In those kind of organisms, photoperiod affects reproduction. So all organisms are also aware of their surroundings. They know what is actually happening around them. And we know that human beings are the only one who is aware of himself. That is, he is the only one who has self-consciousness. He is self-conscious about himself. So consciousness is also the defining property of living organisms. So cellular organization and consciousness are the defining properties of living organisms. So what conclusion can we derive from all that we have learned so far? So all living phenomena are due to underlying reactions. Okay? All living phenomena are due to underlying reactions. If something has to be there, below that something has happened, something has occurred between the constituents. That's what is given here. So properties of tissues are not present in the constituent cells. We know that cells combine to produce tissues, but the properties of tissues are not present in the cells, but the tissues, the properties of tissues arise as a result of the interaction which took place between the cells. Similarly, properties of cellular organelles are not present in the molecular constituents of the organelle, but they arise as a result of the reactions which take place between the molecular constituents comprising the organelle. Okay, so these kind of interactions result in a higher level of organization. So from this we can summarize that living organisms are self-replicating, evolving and self-regulating systems capable of responding to external stimuli. Also, all the living organisms which are in the present or the past or the future, they are linked to each other by a genetic material, but it varies to different degrees. It is DNA in majority of organisms and RNA in fungi. So all these organisms, present, past and future, they are connected by a common genetic material. So talking about diversity in the living world, so when we are looking at a place where a lot of animals and plants and other organisms are present, you will be very amazed to find that there are a lot of range and variety of organisms. And as you increase the area of observation, the range and variety of organisms will also go on be increasing. So such an observation was made by several scientists, and so far the number of species known ranges from 1.7 to 1.8 million. This is known as biodiversity. That is the degree of variation of life forms on Earth. That's known as biodiversity. So the number of species is 1.7 to 1.8 million. That is an important question. 1.7 to 1.8 million. So, as there are a lot of species present on this earth, we need to standardize the naming. Each organism might be known by a local name in many places, but it must be known by a similar name all over the world. That's what is known as nomenclature. So, just we name organisms so that they are known by the same name all over the world. That's what is known as nomenclature. So, nomenclature is possible only when we know to which organism the name has been assigned or whether the organism is described correctly. So we need to identify. So that process is known as identification. So for plants, the scientific names are based on the agreed principles and criteria which are provided in the ICBN, International Code for Botanical Nomenclature. So this is the organization which provides the guidelines and the principles upon which the basis of scientific names for plants are put up. For animal taxonomists, they have evolved an organization, ICZN, International Code for Zoological Nomenclature. So, ICBN and ICZN are for plants and animals respectively. And each organism has only one name. They are very specific about it that each organism is given only one name. So, talking about the name, as I told you, each organism is given only one name. And the name consists of two components, the generic name and the specific epithet. Or we can also put it in other words like genus and species. So, this system of providing two names to every organism is known as binomial nomenclature. Bi means two, so binomial nomenclature. So, binomial nomenclature was given by Carolus Linnaeus. He is considered to be the father of taxonomy. He wrote books, three books he has written, Systema Naturae, Philosophica Botanica and Species Plantarum. And he has spoken about this binomial nomenclature concept in his book Philosophica Botanica. So, he is the father of taxonomy. So, binomial nomenclature is nothing but assigning two names to organisms. For example, let's take the example of mango. So, this scientific name of mango is Mangifera indica. Here, Mangifera is the genus and indica is the species. So, what is nomenclature? What are the rules meant for nomenclature? The names are generally in Latin. Whichever language they are being written, they are just turned out or they are converted into Latin because Latin is a dead language. And it's also written in italics. As you can see here, Mangifera indica is written in italics. And they are Latinized. They must be Latinized. That is a universal rule. And the second thing, the first word must represent the genus and the second word must represent the species. And the first word must begin with a capital letter and the second word must begin with a small letter, as you can see here. And both the words are either separately underlined. You must do either of these two things. Either you have to separately underline both of those terms or you have to italicize. So here I have italicized, as you can see in the case of Mangifera indica. And the name of the author occurs at last, and you can see in the last line here, mango can be written as Mangifera indica Linn, because he is the person who is, you know, cited the name Mangifera indica. So he is the author citation, the author's name is given at the last. So let's ask ourselves. The internationally recognized binomial nomenclature was developed by Linnaeus in his book. Just now we talked about it. It's not Historia Plantarum. It's not Species Plantarum, but Species Plantarum is one of the books written by Linnaeus, but it's not that. It's Philosophica Botanica. Okay, so then we have to talk about classification. What is classification? Classification is the process by which anything is grouped into convenient categories based on some observable characters. So, based on some characters which we can observe, we just put up animal organisms into several categories. That's what is known as classification. So, all these, you know, categories are known as taxa. Singular is taxon and plural is taxa. So taxa can indicate categories at different levels. For example, plant is also a taxon. Whereas, you know, Mangifera indica, Mangifera is also a taxon. Indica is also a taxon. So it's like, it's general, very general. It's highly variable. So all living organisms can be classified into different taxa and this process is known as taxonomy. The word taxonomy was given by A.P.D. Kandel. Okay, the term taxonomy was given by A.P.D. Kandel. That's an important question. So what are the things that we have to look into for modern taxonomic studies? They are external and internal structure along with the structure of the cell, development process and ecological information of organisms. So all these have to be noted upon. All these have to be clearly examined if you have to name an organism and put that into modern taxonomical studies. So what are the steps in taxonomy? What are the processes that are basic to taxonomy? Characterization, identification, classification and nomenclature. As you can see here, characterization, identification, classification and nomenclature are the processes which are basic to taxonomy. So very earlier, during very previous periods, classifications were based on the uses. So based on the uses of organisms, what they provided to us, based on that they were classified. But now it's based on taxonomic and modern taxonomic studies. Then we have a word known as systematics, which is derived from the Latin word systema, and the term was coined by G. Simpson. It's also a systematic arrangement of organisms similar to taxonomy, but only one difference here. There is, it includes evolutionary relationship between organisms, which is not in taxonomy. So the branch of study which takes into account evolutionary relationships while classifying organisms is known as systematics. And Carolus Linnaeus, he wrote a book, Systema Naturae, and that the word systema has been derived from this. The systematics has been derived from that word systema. So that's notable here. So the scope of systematics was later enlarged, and it included identification, nomenclature and classification also. And then we have a new concept which is known as new systematics, or we can coin it as biosystematics, which was given by Julian Huxley in the year 1940. It takes into account almost all the features like phylogeny, karyotaxonomy, that's the, you know, the features related to the chromosome and nucleus, and experimental taxonomy based on various experimental determination of genetic interrelationships and the role of environment. So all these were taken into account by biosystematics, which was given by Julian Huxley in 1940. And we have another nomenclature which is known as trinomial nomenclature. In binomial nomenclature, the first word was genus and the second was species. In trinomial nomenclature, the first is genus, second is species, and the third is subspecies. So what are the taxonomic categories? Taxon, as I told you, that it's a part of the complete taxonomic arrangement. That is, it's a category, that's it. So it's known as a taxonomic category, and on the whole, all the categories are comprisingly called as taxonomic hierarchy. So each category is termed as taxon, as I told you earlier, and this term was given by Adolf Meyer, and in plural form taxon is taxa. So what are groups? Groups represent category, and category denotes rank, and rank, which is the taxon, represents the unit of classification. So these taxonomic categories, these taxa, are not just morphological aggregates. They are not just designed based on the morphology or external features of the organism. They are distinct biological entities. Okay. So due to all of these taxonomic studies of different organisms, we have actually gone to the development of common categories like kingdom, phylum, and for plants, phylum is division, class, order, family, genus, species. So it's kingdom, phylum, class, order, family, genus, species for animals, and kingdom, phylum, you know, kingdom, division, class, order, family, genus, species for plants. So the, what is the basic requirement that is very necessary to place an organism in various categories? It's a knowledge of characters. That is, we need to know what organism possesses what kind of characters. So we can just find out the similarities and dissimilarities in them, and we can put the same kind of organisms, classify them, and put the same kind of organisms under the same taxon. So the types of classification. So taxonomy without phylogeny is like bones without flesh. It's a word put down by Tachtigen. So he says taxonomy without phylogeny. So he brings out the importance of phylogeny, that is the evolutionary relationships between organisms. So phylogenetic tree is known as a dendrogram or cladogram. Also, there is another branch of taxonomy which is phenetics or numerical taxonomy or Adansonian taxonomy. It's based on the observable characters and it involves computerized analysis and recording statistical data. So there are two systems of classification to be precise: artificial system of classification and natural system of classification. So the word itself says artificial. So it's based on superficial similarities, based on a few superficial similarities, and it was adopted by Pliny. It was adopted by a scientist named Pliny, and a very good example for this is the Linnaean classification of, you know, plants based on the number and arrangement of stamens. So he classified plants based on number and arrangement of stamens. That is a very good example for artificial system of classification. But this does not take into account the evolutionary sequence. That is a very big difference between artificial and natural systems of classification. So artificial does not take into account evolutionary sequence, so it's not phylogenetic. Talking about natural system of classification, it's based on anatomical, physiological and morphological characters. And a very good example for this is Bentham and Hooker's system of classification of angiosperms. And it's been specified in the book Genera Plantarum. So this is a phylogenetic system, cladistics. It's based on evolutionary sequence. And it was adopted by three scientists, Engler and Prandtl, in their book Die Nature Lichen, Plants and Familien. And by Hutchinson, who wrote Families of Flowering Plants. So these three scientists have adopted this natural system of classification in their books. Okay, so talking about the first and the basic unit of classification, species. So the term species was defined by John Ray. Species refers to a group of individuals with fundamental similarities. So we must be able to distinguish one species from the other very related species based on some morphological differences. So based on morphological differences, we must be able to differentiate two species. So talking about Mangifera indica, Solanum tuberosum, and Solanum tuberosum is potato, and Panthera leo is lion. In all these terms, indica, tuberosum and leo are the specific epithets. That is, they denote the specific epithets. They occur at the second place. The first ones are the genus. So one genus may have more than one specific epithets, any number of specific epithets. they may represent different organisms, but morphologically they'll be similar. For example, if you take Panthera, earlier we learned only Panthera leo, that's for lion. Here we can take Panthera tigris or Panthera pardus. Panthera tigris is for tiger and Panthera pardus is for leopard. They all are different organisms, but morphologically they are similar. Talking about solanum, we learned about potato, tuberosum, and it also has nigrum and melongenum. Okay, Atropa belladonna and eggplant brinjal. So solanum also has a lot of other species and Panthera also has a lot of other species. Human beings belong to the species Sapiens and the genus to which they belong is Homo. So the scientific name which we have to write for human being is Homo sapiens. So still we have few more facts to be learned under species. If the species are inhabiting the same geographical area, it should be sympatric, and if they are inhabiting different geographical area, it should be allopatric. And some species are restricted to a given area. Only in that place you can find that specific species, it's said to be endemic. And morphologically similar and reproductively isolated species are said to be sibling species. So two concepts of species was proposed. One is typological concept of species, which was given by Plato and Aristotle, and it forms the basis for classical systematics. And the other concept is morphological, which was given by Linnaeus, and it was written in his book Systema Naturae. So morphological concept was given by Linnaeus in his book Systema Naturae. Binomial nomenclature was talked about by Linnaeus in his book. As we learned earlier, it was talked about in his book Philosophica Botanica. So species which have two or more subtypes are said to be polytypic, and species which have no subtypes are said to be monotypic, for example Homo sapiens. So the biological concept of species, the third one, was given by Mayer, and he defined species as population which are reproductively isolated from other groups. So he said that they are reproductively isolated from other groups, and species, he told that species are populations. So static concept of species was given by Linnaeus. So the static concept of species was given by Linnaeus. So let's ask ourselves. A true species consists of population which is sharing the same niche, interbreeding, feeding over the same food, geographically isolated. So obviously the answer would be interbreeding. So just now we learned the definition given by Mayer, but just a slight modification in that. A species is a group of potentially inbreeding populations that are reproductively isolated from other such groups. So just you can include the word inbreeding populations in that definition which we had learned earlier. Again, we have another question. Which taxonomic aid gives comprehensive account? So, type species, holotype, isotype, neotype and paratype. So, talking about holotype, it's an original type specimen and it's used to describe a new species. It's an original type specimen used to describe a new species. Isotype is the duplicate of holotype. Neotype, neo-new, it's a new nomenclature type. And paratype is the specimen described along with holotype. So then we have to talk about genus. Genus, the term genus was also coined by John Ray. Genus is nothing but group of related species and it has more characters in common compared to species. So potato and brinjal, they are two different species but they are put under the same genus, they are solanum. Lion, leopard and tiger, as I told you earlier, are different organisms and they are different. They have different species names like leo, pardus and tigris, but they are put together in a single genus, that is Panthera. And this Panthera differs from another genus, Felis, which includes cats. So Panthera is like, lion, leopard, tiger, that family, and Felis is cat family. So talking about family, it is a group of related genus. And it has less similarities as compared to genus and species. As you go from down to top, species, genus, family, order, class, phylum, kingdom, the similarities goes on decreasing. So family has less number of similar characters. It's characterized on the basis of both vegetative and reproductive features. So for among plants, you can take a family which is known as Solanaceae, which consists of genera like Solanum, Datura and Petunia. Among animals, we have Felidae is the family which includes Felis as its genus. And also it has another genus, Panthera, which comprises of lion, tiger and leopard. So the two genus are put together under Felidae. Felidae is cat family and Canidae is dog family. So they are two different families. Talking about order, order is the assemblage of families with still less number of similarities. So families like Convolvulaceae, Solanaceae are included in the order Polymoniales. And it's mainly based on floral characters, that's important. So the classification is based on floral characters. And the animal order Carnivora, it includes families like Felidae and Canidae, cat family and dog family. Talk about class, its related orders. So the order Primata, which is comprising of monkey, gorilla and gibbon, it's placed in class Mammalia along with order Carnivora. So there are two orders in class Mammalia. They are Primata and Carnivora. Primata are like monkey, gorilla, gibbon, those organisms, and Carnivora, tiger, cat and dog. So all these are put together under class Mammalia. So talking about phylum. Phylum are nothing but classes which comprise animals like fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds, apes, amphibians, reptilia, all these animals put together under the phylum and under a phylum. So all these based on common features like presence of notochord and dorsal hollow neural system are all included in the phylum Chordata. So these fishes, amphibians, reptiles, birds all come under the phylum Chordata. In case of plants, we have another term for phylum, that is division. So in plants we call phylum as division, and it also has very few similar characters as compared to the other taxa. Talk about kingdom, that is the topmost. And all animals belonging to various phyla are assigned to the highest category, which is known as kingdom Animalia. And there is another kingdom, which is kingdom Plantae, which comprises of all the plants. So under kingdom Plantae, there will be divisions, classes, orders, families, genera and species. So you can see the arrangement from down to top as it's given here, ascending order. Species, genus, family, order, class, phylum or division for plants and kingdom. So let's ask ourselves, which of the following is the correct representation of organization levels in living beings? So this is something which we have not learned so far. Subcellular, cellular, individual, community, population. Atomic, molecular, subcellular, cellular, tissue, organ system, individual. Individual, population, organ system, tissue, cellular, molecular, atomic. Atomic, molecular, tissue, individual, ecosystem, community. So when we see such questions, we should not get into a conclusion that we don't know anything about this. We have not even read about this. You can use your common sense to answer such kind of questions. So just read the first one. Subcellular, cellular, individual, community, population. Actually, population is what has to come before community. So that's going to be wrong. Talk about the second one, atomic, okay, atoms form molecules, okay, then they form cells, then they form tissues, and then organ system, then individuals. That sounds to be right, but still let's check the other two options. Individual, they form population, but then after that organ system is not possible. That has to come before individual, right? Talk about the next one, atomic, molecular, immediately tissue can't come. There must be an intermediate which is called as cell. So obviously the answer would be two. So atoms make up molecules and molecules make up the cellular components and cells make up tissues and tissues make up organs. Organs are found as organ systems and they further make up an organism. So you would have seen how easily we answered this question. So don't skip any question that it's very tough or something. You can just apply your common sense to answer a lot of questions. Another question, among all the kingdoms, the only taxon that exists in nature as a biologically cohesive unit is species, genus, phylum or division, kingdom. So the answer for this is species. So this is something important. Taxonomists also have developed subcategories, that is subtaxa we can say. So we can actually, why is this necessary? We can actually place a lot of, you know, organisms in those subtaxa in addition to the primary taxa which are available. So as you go from species to kingdom, as I told you earlier, that the similarities go on decreasing. So lower the taxa, more are the characters that the taxon share. But higher the category, greater is the difficulty to determine the relationship that it has with the other taxa. So talking about the few organisms and their taxa, man, his biological name is Homo sapiens, so genus is Homo, species is sapiens, belongs to the family Hominidae, order Primata, class Mammalia and phylum Chordata, and kingdom Animalia. Talk about housefly, biological name is Musa domestica, genus is Musa, family is Musidae, order Diptera, class Insecta, phylum Arthropoda and kingdom Animalia. Talking about mango, its biological name is Mangifera indica, genus is Mangifera, family Anacardiaceae, order Sapindales, class Dicotyledonae, phylum Angiospermae, kingdom Plantae. Wheat, Triticum asium is its biological name, genus Triticum, family Poaceae, order Poales, class Monocotyledonae, phylum Angiospermae and kingdom Plantae. So what are the taxonomical aids? So we need to actually classify and identify organisms so that we can make the process of taxonomy a very big success. So identification requires intensive laboratory and field study. So we have to also collect many specimens of plants and animals, and that is actually the prime source of taxonomic studies. That is, you know, that's a primary thing which is required for taxonomy. So there are a lot of procedures and techniques which have been established by biologists so that we can preserve the information as well as the specimens also. So the first among them is herbarium. Herbarium is a storehouse of all the plant specimens. They are collected, they are dried, and they are pressed, and they are preserved on sheets. And these sheets are arranged according to a system of classification, universally accepted system of classification. So all these specimens will be having a label with them, which carries information about the date of collection and where it was collected, who collected it, and the family to which it belongs, and the English, local, and botanical names. So this becomes a storehouse for all the taxonomic use and all that. So also a quick referral system in taxonomical studies. Talking about botanical gardens, they are actually places where live plants are kept. So plant species are grown for identification purposes, and each plant is labeled with its botanical name and its family also, so that we can just get an idea of what this plant is and to which family it belongs to. So the famous botanical gardens are Kew at England, Indian Botanical Garden at Howrah of India, and National Botanical Research Institute of Lucknow of India. So Kew of England is the largest botanical garden in the world. Talking about museum, museum is actually dead specimens, a house of dead specimens. So it has preserved plant and animal specimens, and it's used for study and reference. In schools and colleges it's usually set up. And the specimens are conserved in jars or in preservative solutions. They will be put into some preservative solutions like formaldehyde. And plant and animal specimens will also be preserved as rice specimens. And the insects are collected, they are killed, and they are pinned, and they are stored in museums. Also, birds and mammals are usually stuffed and preserved. And we also have real man skeletons and animal skeletons also in the museums. Talking about zoological parks, these are where wild animals are kept and proper care is being given to them. And they are kept under human care so that we can know what their behavior is and what food they take and what kind of adaptations they go through. All these things we can learn by developing a zoological park. So all animals in a zoo are provided conditions which they will be getting in their natural habitat. So they are commonly called zoos. So let's ask ourselves. National Zoological Park is located at Delhi, Lucknow, Jaipur, Darjeeling. So anyone at one side will definitely tell Delhi, because that's a national, national capital of India. So they would guess that that's the National Zoological Park of India. So this is purely factual. Actually, there is no concept behind this. So let's check the answer. Yeah, that's Delhi. Congrats to people who thought Delhi. So talking about key, the word key and the concept key was developed by John Ray for identification of animals. And key is another taxonomical aid which is used for identification of plants and animals. It's based on similarities and dissimilarities. You just accept one thing and reject the other. That's what. Contrasting characters. And it's always present in the pair. One and one. A pair, that's a couplet. And each one is known as a let. Each statement is known as a let. So you have to make a choice between the two options. And you have to accept one and you have to reject one. So separate keys are there for separate taxon, like for kingdom there is a key, and for genus there is a key, and for species there is a key, and these keys are analytical in nature. And there are also other aids like flora, manuals, monographs and catalogs. They are also used in recorded descriptions and they play a vital role in taxonomic studies. Also they help us in correct identification. So flora, the word itself says plants. Flora is for plants and fauna is for animals. So flora, it contains the account of all the habitat of wherever the plants are living, and distribution, where all the plants are being distributed, and it provides an index to the plant species. In a particular area, these many plant species are found and their biological names are so and so. That's what a flora contains. Talk about manuals. Manuals, the word itself says name book, right? So it's something which it's a piece of book which contains information for the identification of names of species found in any area. Monographs, so one, mono is one. So it contains information on any one taxon, on any one kingdom or any one species or any one genus. So let's ask ourselves, which taxonomic aid gives comprehensive account of complete compiled information of a genus or family at a particular time? That's a pretty easy question. Of a genus or family, so that's obviously going to be monograph, because it's per, right? It's one, so it's monograph. So if anyone has doubt from where these questions have been taken from, there is a book which is known as MTG Objective NCERT at your fingertips. MCQs extracted from each line of NCERT textbooks, as you can see here. So this is the book, MTG. So from this book, all of these questions have been taken from. So you can also buy this book to practice. For each lesson, they have given nearly 100 questions, which are really worthy. And you can expect such kind of similar questions for the exam too. Okay, that's it for today. Hope you understood the entire topic pretty well. Subscribe to my channel if you have not done so far. Like and share this video to whomever you know. Meet you soon with a lot of other lectures on various other subjects on various other chapters. Thank you so much.